Okay, at the start of the year, third degree reporter Samantha Hayes heard a song by a 16-year-old Takapuna grammar student. The song gave her goosebumps.
That's right, you'll know this song. It's called Royals, and it completely reverberated around the globe. So much so that it's come within an inch of topping the US music charts.
And while all that was going on, Samantha Hayes has been following Lorde closely. She's been filming with her and watching her rise and rise and rise.
It's Saturday night in Auckland, and thousands of fans are waiting to see Lorde play live. In the wings is the 16-year-old Takapuna grammar student that's got the whole world talking.
So Ella, how are you feeling just before the gig?
Good, very nervous.
Do you actually get nervous?
I do. I get like disgustingly nervous. And this is the biggest indoor crowd.
And what about pre-show rituals? Do you have anything that makes you feel a little bit better?
I just like to sit by myself and kind of feel like
get there. Okay. Well, we'll leave you to it. Good
Thank
luck.
You. Thanks. Enjoy. Thanks.
It may seem like Ella Yelich O'Connor has catapulted from no one to superstar in a heartbeat. But the truth is, she spent most of her life working towards this moment.
Like the most natural thing in the world to me because, you know, I've never had anyone else's music career. So I, you know, this feels like normality, really. I don't know, I mean, I love it. I get to do these crazy things that a lot of people wouldn't necessarily get to do.
And in her flowing robe, Ella looks every bit a lord. She gave herself the stage name because of her fascination with aristocracy, adding an E on the end to feminize it.
Everything about this business is outlandish and extravagant. I don't know, man, I mean, this is entertainment. It's this magical world.
A magical world where suddenly everyone's singing along with you and your song is about to be a number one hit in the US, a feat only two other Kiwis have achieved. But there would be no Lorde, at least not as we know her, without this man. Scott McLaughlin is an industry A&R guy. Essentially, his job is to find new acts. And he found Ella when she was just 12 at her school talent quest.
She's a perfect storm of a lot of things. Intelligence, charisma, vocal ability, confidence, humility. You know, just every box that you can tick for an A&R guy, she ticks in spades.
I just don't want to keep moving without nailing some of these as well.
Yeah, totally.
So, at 13, he signed her to the world's largest record company, Universal Music, and became her manager and closest advisor.
If you go too pop, there's no way back.
Yeah.
It's still got to feel like Lorde.
But then came the question of how to turn Ella into a viable act. His first idea was to get her to sing other people's songs.
My sort of strategy was completely different to what ended up, really. which really was, okay, we have a great voice, and one of the traditional routes is that you get other people to write songs for someone with a great voice, and you put the two together and off you go. And that's not how it turned out.
At the time, I wasn't really writing, so I guess I didn't give Scott much to go on. And he just saw me as a voice, so he was like, well, you know, you could do this like cover album, you know, like I think like Joss Stone did something similar, which was like, I don't know what he was thinking. But I knew that was not what I was gonna be doing. Just cause, you know, I wanna do my own thing. I was like, no, give me some time.
Okay.
And I wrote.
Are you ready?
Yeah, what's happening?
Ella spent 2 years honing her writing skills, penning short stories. Then at 15, Scott put the terrified teenager into the studio with music producer Joel Little.
I heard her voice and was like, you know, this is a ridiculously good voice. Like, she came with the lyrics to Royals and I was like, man, these are so good. We've got to, you know, something special could come out of this.
Yeah.
And so we spent a couple of days kind of nutting it out. And then we cracked it and I was like, this feels really good.
In under a week, they made the hit song Royals. They didn't know it yet, but it would turn Ella into an international star.
I've never seen a diamond in the flesh. I cut my teeth on wedding rings in the movies. And I'm not.
When we kind of finished it up and I listened back the first time, I was like, there's something about this. Like, I wasn't thinking that it would go as crazy as it did, but I was like, I know that there's, you know, something magical about this track.
But every song's like gold teeth, grey goose dripping in the bathroom, bloodstains, ball gowns, trash in the hotel room, we don't care. We're driving Cadillacs in our dreams.
I put Royals on and I freaked out. So that's how this whole story began.
American music executive Jason Flom has been handpicking stars for 3 decades and found Royals 48 hours after it was posted online.
You know, we have a saying in the music industry, get to the chorus and don't bore us. But the fact is, with her, with that song, it catches you from the moment it comes on.
My friends and I, we've cracked the code.
Scott,
how are you?
I'm well, thanks. Glad to be here, yeah.
Awesome.
Flom immediately signed Lorde to his US label Lava Records.
What we do in this crazy business of ours is we market magic, right? And so there's either magic in a record or there's not. And it's all subjective, but the fact is the voice, the lyrics, the melody, all were just sort of shocking.
And we'll never be royal.
But at this stage, only a handful of people knew who the girl behind the song was. This illustration was the only hint at what she looked like.
Oh, that was 100% my decision. Just because I feel like pop music places a lot of importance on, you know, looks, and there's a lot of kind of excess information, I feel like, in pop. You know everything about everyone, and I don't know if that's necessary to enjoy music. I'd like it if people judge my music on something apart from what my face looked like, or, you know, what my body looked like, or anything like that. I liked that in the beginning people could listen and like it based on nothing except the fact that they liked the music, you know?
Let me live that fantasy.
I just wanted cool.
Ella's control extends to everything she puts her name to, even how her songs are consumed. She released all her early material, including Royals, online for free. And 60,000 copies were downloaded without a cent being paid for them.
What did the record company make of all of that?
Giving it away for free.
Yeah.
They didn't like it. I was like, this is what I want to do. And everyone was like, But I'm so glad I did it. It was a smart move in terms of getting it out there. And it's just a cool way of doing it, I think.
And when it was finally released on iTunes, the single went straight to number one.
Pretty soon I'll be getting on my first plane.
But Ella had yet to translate her songs to the stage. Lorde had never once performed in front of an audience.
Oh, I was nervous. It was bad. I was very stressed out. Just because, you know, like you said, there was a lot, you know, emotionally invested in me as an artist. Even at that point, I was like, oh, I've got to deliver. Let's go down to the tennis court.
So at this point back in May, Lorde had all the major record deals underway. She had the number one hit in New Zealand, but there was a big doubt about her because no one was sure how she'd actually perform on the stage.
Yeah, bit of a catch, but we are there for this high-pressure moment, her first performance.
Welcome back. Well, 4 months ago, Lorde had never given a concert and no one actually knew if she could do it.
That's right, but they were pretty keen to find out when she held a pub gig. It sold out in 90 seconds.
We wouldn't be seen dead here in the day.
Ella arrives for soundcheck in knee-high socks and a backpack.
If I like it, then we'll stay.
This will be Lorde's first ever live performance. It's 4 months before her Vector Arena show and completely different. There's no entourage, just a couple of roadies to set up. At her age, she shouldn't even be here in a pub. And her pre-gig demands reflect that.
Hey, have you got anything special in your rider?
Well, I kind of have alcohol in my rider, obviously. So my rider is super boring. It's like water and Red Bull. Water and Red Bull.
Do you know what your first song is going to be? Have you settled on a set list at this point?
Yeah, we have.
What is it?
It's a track off my EP called Bravado.
Hey, hey. Two, 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 yeah.
I'm quite a shy person, I guess, in general. Like, and Bravado is putting on a front, you know, like false confidence sort of, so it was about me having to come to terms with having to be in the limelight, I guess, and you know, and having to have that degree of confidence to get up in front of people and do something like this. So
it's a good song to open on then. That's a good one.
it's pretty appropriate, I think.
There's no shy teenager from the North Shore on the stage. And Ella proves she can recreate the magic from the studio live.
Two bar counts in and then you start singing.
Drink you spilt all over me.
Back at Golden Age Studio, Ella and Joel are working on material which will make it onto her first full-length album.
Sounds good.
Oh, God.
The morning husk kind of adds to it.
Oh, God.
Are you ready?
Yeah, go.
This dream isn't feeling sweet. We're reeling through the midnight streets and I've never felt more alone. Feels so scary getting old. This dream isn't feeling sweet. We're reeling through the midnight streets and I've never felt more alone. Feels so scary getting old.
This is the journey of a yet-to-be-released song called Ribs, from studio to stage.
But we don't have a chorus.
No, it needs to go. It feels like you've got those lovely two verses that build and build. Then you go into the middle eight, which takes you higher, and then it stops. And that's why I don't feel there's any resolution. You
that's
go,
what I like about
ta-da!
It. No, because that's exactly what you expect to happen.
When you are in the studio and you're doing this kind of thing, do you get does it feel a little bit daunting at all, or is it quite natural to you?
I think it's daunting trying to appeal to the perfectionist in me. I'm like, will I like this on the train home today, or will I like it in the morning, you know? But I guess we don't really think about outside pressures when we're in here. Mm-hmm. It's more like we're making the track, and then if other people like it or don't like it, that's an added thing, you know?
Okay.
We were down at the hospital, waiting for you to get well.
Ella's never studied music, but she's a storyteller.
The ambulance you laughing.
Her songs reject the usual glamour of pop music. Instead, she writes wistful tales about the everyday lives of teenagers.
The real fun was when we were young. Let's go back.
The chorus I was wondering about.
Yeah, me too.
And this is better than being at school.
Oh, it's so much better. I love you, Shakira Grandma, but yeah, it's awesome. I love it here.
You know, because you kind of forget that she's got to go home and, you know, not stay up all night. Mm. Has that ever got you in trouble when you sort of just get caught up in recording?
Yeah, we have had times where it's been midnight and I've just totally forgotten to say, oh, you know, do you need to call your parents or anything like that? And then get a text from her mum, like, you know, where the hell is my daughter? And I'm like, oh, shit. You know, that's right.
There's a humming in the restless summer air, and we're slipping off the course that we prepared. But in all chaos, there is calculation. Dropping glasses just to hear them break. You've been drinking like the world was.
In just a few months, life's changed dramatically. The meteoric rise of Lorde has opened doors everywhere. And Alice had some big decisions to make.
Is it true that you turned down a support act spot on Katy Perry's worldwide tour?
I think she's really talented. I just don't think it was quite right for me.
That's a huge call.
Oh, God.
Was that a tough decision?
No. I have a pretty good gut instinct for stuff, and if something feels right, I'll do it.
I mean, you are her manager. You know how much money that could have made.
Money never comes into it.
So it's never about
it's never
money?
Never come into
it. It's still a huge decision to make. Whether you take it or not.
I honestly don't think it is, because if you make that wrong decision early on, it really shortens her career. Mm. And you know, I this is my fifth year with her, so I'm a patient man. I think it's lovely to be asked, and and it's an honour for someone like that, you know, to say, oh look, you know, join me on tour and whilst I play stadiums. But really, it's about Katy Perry. It's not about Lorde.
Alice and her circle truly believe this is just the beginning for her. That with her songwriting and intelligence, there won't be only one number one hit for the history books. She's been lauded as the voice of her generation. Just as well then, at 16, Alice found her voice. Let's go down to the tennis court and talk it up like you.
I don't know if it'll always be my career. I don't know if people will always want to book me for festivals or whatever, but I'm always going to do it. You know, I know that. I like it too much not to do it for the foreseeable future, I think.
Wow, she's cool, isn't she? And her first album, Ella's first album, Pure Heroine, is out next Friday. That's Friday week.
But it's already on iTunes New Zealand, where it has gone straight to number one based on pre-sales before anyone has even heard it. And that hit song, Royals, has sold more than 1 million copies in the United States.